Let's begin with our first panel for the day. Today's first panel shall cover the role of energy efficiency and sustainable energy in empowering agriculture value chains. We shall see examples of how and where energy access plays a role in catalyzing the rest of the agriculture ecosystem and what are the barriers in scaling these solutions. To set the context, we'd like to call upon a duo, founder of an organization which works towards building self-help groups and creating essential linkages for them to access sustainable energy solutions. And then an end user who's been a part of the SDG and provided with appropriate solutions. Mr. A. Manjunatha is the founder of Jenugoodu Community Managed Resource Center under MYRADA in MM Health. He started social work in 2004 and has been working in MM Health since 2008. He works with around 3,000 families across 29 remote villages, out of which 950 families were unelectrified, all of whom are completely electrified with solar power now. They monitor around 90 community-based organizations like SHGs, WMAs, and federations, and also legal awareness conducting camps among others. And then the end user, Shivamma, an agri-processing entrepreneur from Tulsi Kere village in MM Health. She runs a decentralized solar millet processing unit to process ragi, the finger millet. Shivamma's enterprise provides decentralized millet processing services to her neighbors and neighboring hamlets. Her social enterprise has resulted in many of the inhabitants of MM Health having significant savings earlier incurred due to the vast distances her customers had to travel prior to this. So I welcome both of them on stage. Shivamma and Manjunatha, very to really give a welcome to you.
ನಾನು ಮಾನ್ಯ ಮಾದೇಶ್ವರ ಅಂತ ರಿಮೋಟ್ ಏರಿಯಾ ಚಾಮರಾಜನಗರ ಜಿಲ್ಲೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ರಿಮೋಟ್ ಏರಿಯಾದಲ್ಲಿ ವರ್ಕ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೀನಿ. ಮೈರಾಡ ನನ್ನ ಮಾತಾಡ್ಸಂತೆ ನಾವು ಅದೇ ಎಮ್ ಪಿ ಐ ಮೈರಾಡ ಪ್ರಮೋಟೆಡ್ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಷನ್ ಜೇನುಗೂಡು ಸೇಮ್ ಕಮ್ಯುನಿಟಿ ಮ್ಯಾನೇಜ್ ರಿಸೋರ್ಸ್ ಸೆಂಟರ್ ಅಂತ ಅದನ್ನು ನಡೆಸ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೀವಿ. ಸಮ್ ಎರಡು ಸಾವಿರದ ಎರಡರಿಂದ ನಾವು ಮಲೆ ಮಾದೇಶ್ವರ ಬೆಟ್ಟ ಏರಿಯಾದಲ್ಲಿ ವರ್ಕ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ವಿ. ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಮೆಜಾರಿಟಿ ಪ್ರಿಮಿಟಿವ್ ಸೋಲಿಗಾ ಡ್ರೈವರ್ಸ್ ಮತ್ತು ಬೇಡಗಪ್ಪ ನಾಸ್ ಅನ್ನೋ ಒಂದು ಜನ ವಾಸ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ. ಇಲ್ಲಿ ರೋಡ್ ಆಕ್ಸೆಸಿಬಿಲಿಟಿ ತುಂಬಾ ಇಲ್ಲೂ ಇಲ್ಲ. ಒಂದು ಸುಮಾರು ಒಂದು ಮೂರು ಹಳ್ಳಿಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಮತ್ತೆ ಎಲೆಕ್ಟ್ರಿಸಿಟಿ ಫೆಸಿಲಿಟಿಗೂ ಸಹ ಇಲ್ಲ ಇಲ್ಲಿ.
As I explained, this is Manjunath, is part of MYRADA's center, Jenugoodu, which is a community development center. And as he is explaining, the place where they are from is quite remote. There's no road access to that place, and also electricity is a very far away amenity for them.
So, ಇಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಸುಮಾರು 2019 ವರ್ಕ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಶುರು ಮಾಡಿದ್ವಿ. ಅಲ್ಲಿವರೆಗೂ ಅಲ್ಲಿರುವಂಥ ಜನಗಳು ಬ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಅಂದರೆ ಗೊತ್ತಿರಲಿಲ್ಲ. ಆ ಅಂಥ ಒಂದು ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಎಸ್ ಎ ಜಿ ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಕೆಪಾಸಿಟಿ ಬಿಲ್ಡಿಂಗ್ ಟ್ರೈನಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಮಾಡಿ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ನೀಡ್ ಬೇಸಿಡ್ ಸರ್ವಿಸಸ್ಗಳನ್ನ ನಾವು ಲೈನ್ ಡಿಪಾರ್ಟ್ಮೆಂಟು ಬ್ಯಾಂಕ್ಸು ಮತ್ತು ಅಲ್ಲಿಗಳನ್ನ ಆಪ್ರೇಟ್ ಮಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಶುರು ಮಾಡಿದ್ವಿ.
So it's they started working there since from 2002, and it's an area where people had no idea of linkage to financing. I mean, banks, the access to banks were not there. In such a place, they started working, and they started working with these self-help groups and started making those financial linkages for them.
ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಮುಖ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಎಲೆಕ್ಟ್ರಿಸಿಟಿ ಸೌಲಭ್ಯಗಳಿಂದ ಒಂದು ತುಳಸಿಗಳು ಇಲ್ಲ ಸುಮಾರು ಹಳ್ಳಿಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಅವರು ಈಗ ಫ್ಲೋರ್ ಬಿಲ್ ಆಗಲಿ ಮತ್ತು ಲೈಟಿಂಗ್ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆ ಆಗಲಿ ಮಕ್ಕಳಿಗೆ ಎಜುಕೇಷನ್ ಆಗಲಿ ತುಂಬಾ ಅವಶ್ಯಕತೆ ಇರುವಂಥ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಸೆಲ್ಕೋ ಜೊತೆ ಒಂದು ಸಂಬಂಧ ಬೆಳೆಸ್ಕೊಂಡು ಅಲ್ಲಿ 2009 ಲೈಟಿಂಗ್ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರು. ಆಲ್ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ 100% ನಾವು ಎಲ್ಲ ಒಂದು 950 ಮನೆಗೆ ಲೈಟಿಂಗ್ ಸೌಲಭ್ಯನ ಕೊಡಿಸಿದ್ರು.
So in that area, as I was explaining, there's no electricity. So in such a place, they actually collaborated with SELCO to provide home lighting system to more than 950 households there, and also providing livelihood solutions because of there was a lack of electricity, there was a lack of capacity building. So it's not just providing electricity, but solar power solutions, along with they actually worked towards building capacity building as well.
ಇದಕ್ಕೆ ಫಂಡಿಂಗ್ ಬಂದು ಎಸ್ ಎಚ್ ಜಿಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಎಸ್ ಎಚ್ ಜಿ ಮೂಲಕ ಮಾಡಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೆ. ಮತ್ತೆ ಬ್ಯಾಂಕರ್ಸ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿರುವಂತ ಬ್ಯಾಂಕರ್ಸ್ ಮತ್ತೆ ಎಂ ಎಫ್ ಐಗಳು ನಮ್ಗೆ ಆ ಒಂದು ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಚಟುವಟಿಕೆಗಳನ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ಅನುಷ್ಠಾನ ಮಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಸಪೋರ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರು. ಸೊ ಅದನ್ನ ಕರೆಕ್ಟ್ ರೂಟ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಮೊಬಿಲೈಸ್ ಮಾಡಿ, ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಅವಶ್ಯಕತೆ ಇರೋದ್ರೆ ಮೊಬಿಲೈಸ್ ಮಾಡಿ, ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಇಂಟರ್ ಮಾಡಿ, ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ
They work through creating self-help groups for self-help groups to do the financing for these communities. Either it comes from SDGs itself, or they work with the banks to mobilize the financing through the banks to these communities.
After lighting ಆದ್ಮೇಲೆ ಬೇರೆ ಒಂದು ಯಾವ ಏರಿಯಾದಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡ್ಬೋದು ಅಂತ ಯೋಚನೆ ಮಾಡೋದು. ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಅಗತ್ಯವಿರುವಂತಹ ಒಂದೊಂದು ಚಟುವಟಿಕೆ ನಾವು ಇನ್ಸ್ಟಾಲ್ ಮಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಹೋಗಿ, ಒಂದು ನೀರಿನ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆ ಆಗಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಬೋರನ್ನು ಅದು ಸೋಲಾರ್ ಎನರ್ಜಿ ಮೂಲಕ ನಾವು ಅದನ್ನ ಮೊಬೈಲ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ವಿ ಸೆಂಟ್ರಲ್ ಫೌಂಡೇಶನ್ ಮೂಲಕ. ಅದಾದ ನಂತರ ಈಗ ಫ್ಲೋರ್ ಮಿನ್ಗೆ ಸುಮಾರು 9-10 ಕಿಲೋಮೀಟರ್ ನಡ್ಕೊಂಡೋಗ್ಬೇಕು ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ವೆಹಿಕಲ್ ಫೆಸಿಲಿಟಿ ಏನಿದೆ ಈಗ. ಸೊ
So after the home lightings were done, then they looked at what other solutions can be for the solar. Considering the, again as we were discussing yesterday, to do the, I mean after doing the right rate assessment, what kind of livelihoods actually make sense for the communities, they saw one solution was as is explaining solar pump for the water solution, as well as now the one we are going to discuss is the solar powered flour mill, because people had to walk more than 10 kilometers to actually get their grains floured.
ಮತ್ತೆ ಆ ಫ್ಲೋರ್ ಮಿಲ್ ಗೋಸ್ಕರ ಅವ್ರು ಒಂದಿನ ಎಲ್ಲ ಕೆಲಸ ಬಿಟ್ಟಾರೆ ಹೋಗ್ಬೇಕು, ಅವ್ರದ್ದು ರೂಟೀನ್ ಕೆಲಸಗಳೇನಿರ್ತಾವೆ ಅದನ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಒಂದಿನ ಎಲ್ಲ ಅಲ್ಲಿಗೆ ಹೋಗ್ಬೇಕು, ಮಲೆ ಮನುಷ್ಯರಲ್ಲಿ ಬಂದು ಅಲ್ಲಿ ವೇಟ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಅದು ಮಾಡಿಸ್ಕೊಂಡು ಬರಬೇಕು, ಮತ್ತೆ ಕ್ಯಾರಿ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು, ಇದೆಲ್ಲ ತುಂಬಾನೇ ಹಿಂಸೆಗಳಾಗ್ತಾ ಇದ್ವು. ಸೊ ಈ ಒಂದು ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆಗೆ ಪರ್ಯ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆ ಏನು ಅಂತ ಯೋಚನೆ ಮಾಡುವಾಗ ನಾವು ಸೆಲ್ಕೋ ಫೌಂಡೇಶನ್ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಅವರ ಕೋಟಿಗೆ ಮಾತಾಡಿ ಅವರು ಟೆಕ್ನಿಷಿಯನ್ಸ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಬಂದು ಫೀಲ್ಡ್ ಬಂದು ಫೀಲ್ಡ್ ಫೀಲ್ಡ್ ಸ್ಟಡಿ ಮಾಡಿ ಒಂದು ಫ್ಲೋರ್ ಮಿಲ್ಲೆಲ್ಲ ಒಂದು ಇನ್ಸ್ಟಾಲೇಷನ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರು.
So most of these people who are there are the daily laborers, right? So if even if they go to get their mills, get their grains mill to get flour, it will take a day for them to just go and come back. That's a loss of one day's labor. So they thought, okay, why can't we have a flour milling machine itself in that locality? So after the right intervention, so they installed the solar powered flour milling machine.
So ಇದಕ್ಕೆ ಬೇಕಾದಂತ ಸಪೋರ್ಟ್ ಎಸ್ಎಲ್ಜಿ ಮೂಲಕ ಮತ್ತೆ ಬ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಮೂಲಕ ನಾವು ಮೊಬಿಲೈಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಂಡ್ವಿ. ಸೊ ಈಗ ಫ್ಲೋರ್ ಮಿಲ್ ಯೂನಿಟ್ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟಾಲ್ ಆಗಿದೆ. ಸೊ ಸಕ್ಸಸ್ಫುಲ್ ಆಗಿ ರನ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದಾರೆ. ಸೊ ಈ ರೀತಿ ಚಟುವಟಿಕೆಗಳನ್ನ ನಮ್ಮಲ್ಲಿ ಇನ್ನೂ ಸಾಕಷ್ಟು ನೀಡ್ ಬೇಸ್ಡ್ ಸರ್ವೆ ಮಾಡಿ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ.
ನಾನು ಫಸ್ಟು ಸುಮ್ಮನೆ ಮನೇಲಿ ಇದ್ದೀನಿ, ನಾನು ಯಜಮಾನರು ಹೊರಗಡೆ ಕೂಡಿಗೆ ಹೋಗ್ತಾ ಇದ್ರು, ಅದೇ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಎರಡು ಮಕ್ಕಳು, ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಸ್ಕೂಲ್ ಹೋಗ್ಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ನಾನು ಬೆಟ್ಟಕ್ಕೆ ಸ್ಕೂಲ್ ಸೇರಿಸಿದ, ಅದೇ ನಮಗೆ ಮಕ್ಕಳುಗಳಿಗೆ ಹೋಗ್ಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಅವ್ನ ಲೈಟ್ ಇರಲಿಲ್ಲ ಫಸ್ಟು, ಅದೇ ಮುಂದಿನ ಸಾರಿಂದ ನಮಗೆ ಎಲ್ಪಾಗಿ ಲೈಟ್ ಹಾಕ್ಸ್ಕೊಟ್ರು. ಆಮೇಲೆ ಆದರೆ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಏನು ಕೂಲಿ ಇರಲಿಲ್ಲ, ನಮ್ಮ ಯಜಮಾನರು ಹೊರಗಡೆ ಹೋಗಿ ಕೂಲಿ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ರು. ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಇವಾಗ ಫೋರ್ಮಿಂದು ಮಾಡಿ ನೀವು ನೆನೆಸ್ಕೊಡಿ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ಹಾಕ್ಸ್ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಇವಾಗ ನಾನು ಕೋರ್ಬೇಕು, ಅವ್ರನ್ನ ರಾಗಿ ಇಟ್ಟಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಅಕ್ಕಿ ಇಟ್ಟು ಗೋಧಿ ಎಲ್ಲ ಇಟ್ಟು ಹುಡ್ಕೊಂಡು ಹೋಗ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೀವಿ. ಇವಾಗ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿ ಸುಮಾರು ಫಸ್ಟ್ ನಮಗೆ ಅತಿ ತೊಂದರೆ ಇತ್ತು, ಅದು ನಮಗೆ
ಸೊ ಹರ್ ಫ್ಯಾಮಿಲಿ ಇಸ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಎಂಎಂ ಹೆಲ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಶಿ ವಾಸ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಲೇನಿಂಗ್ ಶಿ ವಾಸ್ ಅಟ್ ಹೋಮ್ ಅಂಡ್ her husband was going for daily labor, and she has two kids as well. Through solar interventions, she's got the home lighting as well, and now as he was telling, now she runs the solar milling, the solar powered flour mill in her locality. It's rice and then ragi, and then all the grains that are grown in the locality, now they don't have to travel far away, they can come to her and get a grain.
ಹೊರಗಡೆ ಹೋಗಿ ಕೂಲಿ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಂಡು ಮಾತಾಡಿದ್ರು, ಇವಾಗ ಅದೇ ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೀವಿ. ಆದ್ರೆ ನಾವು ಇನ್ನು ಮುಂದೆ ಓಪನ್ ಮಿಲ್ಲಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಈಗ ಇಟ್ಟಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಅದೇನೋ ಮಾಡಿದ್ವಿ. ಇವಾಗ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ನಮಗೆ ಸುಮಾರು ಸಹಾಯ ಆಯ್ತಾ ಇದೆ. ಅದೇ ಹೊರಗಡೆ ಇನ್ಮೇಲಿಂದ ನಾವು ಯಜಮಾನರು ಇನ್ನೂ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಸಾಲ ಎಲ್ಲ ತೀರಿಸ್ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಮನೇಲಿ ಇಟ್ಕೋತೀವಿ, ಇನ್ನೂ ಏನು ಮುಂದೆ ಇಂಪ್ರೂವ್ ಆಗುವಂತ ಸಾಧ್ಯತೆ ಕಂಡು ಬರ್ತಾ ಇದೆ. ನಮ್ಮ ಜನ ಸರಿಂದ ನಮ್ಗೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಗುರುತಿಸ್ತಾರೆ. ನಾವು ಅಷ್ಟು ನಮ್ಗೇನು ಇರಲಿಲ್ಲ, ಒಂದು ರೂಪಾಯಿನೂ ನಾವು ಸಂಪಾದನೆ ಇಲ್ಲ. ನಾವು ಏನ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕಾದ್ರು ನಮ್ಮ ಯಜಮಾನ್ರೆ ಕಾಯ್ಬೇಕಾಗಿತ್ತು. ಇವಾಗ ನಮ್ಮ ಸರ್ಬಂದಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಗುರುತಿಸಿ ಈಗ ಒಂದು ಸುಮಾರಾಗಿ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಏನೋ ಒಂದು ಸಹಾಯ ನಮ್ಗಾಯ್ತು.
Talks about empowerment. Previously she had to wait for husband to even to get a rupee to even to buy something for her kids or to have access to it. Right now, because she's running the mill, she's got the financial independence as well. And her husband is currently working in Delhi labor, but the plan is to, because the mill is doing pretty well, the plan is to actually, he'll come back and they want to expand and see how can other things to be added, how can they expand the small business that they have there.
ಮುಂದೆ ಇನ್ನೂ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಸಾಲ ತಿಳ್ಕ ಮೇಲೆ ಇನ್ನು ನಾವು ನಮ್ಮ ಯಜಮಾನ್ರ ಮನೇಲಿ ಇಸ್ಕೊಂಡು ಏನೋ ಮುಂದೆ ಮತ್ತೆ ಇಂಪ್ರೂವ್ ಆಗ್ಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಅನ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ವಿ. ಅದೇ ಅದು ನಮಗೂ ನಮ್ಗೇನು ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಏನೂ ಗೊತ್ತಿರಲಿಲ್ಲ, ನಿಲ್ ಬಗ್ಗೆನೂ ಗೊತ್ತಿಲ್ಲ. ನಾವೇನು ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ನಮಗೆ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಾಯ್ತಾ ಇರಲಿಲ್ಲ, ತುಂಬ ಭಯ ಆಯಿತು. ಮತ್ತೆ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಕಂಪ್ನಿಯಿಂದ ನಮಗೆಲ್ಲ ಹೆಲ್ಪ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರು. ಅದೇ ನಮ್ಮ ಸರ್ ಬಂದು ಏನೋ ತೊಂದರೆ ಆಯಿತು ಅಂದರೆ ಸರ್ ಹಿಂಗೆ ಆಯಿತು ಅಂತ ನಮ್ಮ ಸರ್ಗೆ ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ.
ಯಾರು ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ ನೀವು
ನಾವು ಹಳ್ಳಿಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ರಾಗಿ ಅವರೆ ಇದು ಎಲ್ಲ ಬೆಳೀತಾ ಇದ್ದೀವಿ. ಅದೇ ಅದ ತಂದು ನಾವು ಮುಂದೆ ತಗೊಂಡು ಹೋಗ್ಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಒಂದು 7 ಕಿಲೋಮೀಟ್ರು ತಲೆ ಮೇಲೆ ರಾಗಿ ಹೊತ್ಕೊಂಡು ಬೆಟ್ಟಕ್ಕೆ ಮಲೆ ಮಲಿಸ್ತರ ಬೆಟ್ಟಕ್ಕೆ ಬರ್ಬೇಕಿತ್ತು ನಾವು.
So I just asked, from where do people actually get those the grains to be milled? So it's all the local farmers. So it's not a massive milling machine where they're doing like tons per hour, but it's a small milling machine where it suffices the need for the locality. And also she was saying they had to walk climbing the mountain because it's a hilly area and carrying it on their head, like ragi, the finger millet and all the grains. Now they don't have to do it, they can come to the milling machine, the flour mill, and can get it done.
ಅಷ್ಟು ನಮ್ಗೇನು ಇರಲಿಲ್ಲ. ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ತಲೆ ಮೇಲೆ ಹೊತ್ಕೊಂಡು ಬಂದ್ರೆ ಒಂದ್ ದಿವಸ ಪೂರ್ತಿ ಬೆಳಿಗ್ಗೆ ಒಂದು 10 ಗಂಟೆ ಅಷ್ಟು ಹೊತ್ತಿಗೆ ಬಿಟ್ರೆ, ಮನೆ ಬಿಟ್ರೆ ಸಾಯಂಕಾಲ ಒಂದ್ 4 ಗಂಟೆ ಇದ್ದಂತೆ ಅಲ್ಲಾಯ್ತು. ಆದ್ರೆ ಇವಾಗ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಫೋನ್ ಮೇಲೆ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿರೋದ್ರಿಂದ ಅದೇ ಅವಾಗ ಮನೇಲಿ ಏನ್ ಕೆಲಸ ಬೇಕಾದ್ರೂ ಮಾಡ್ಬೋದು. ಇವಾಗ ಬಂದು ಅಲ್ಲೇ ಮಿಲ್ ಮಾಡಿಸ್ಕೊತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅದೇ ನಮ್ಮ ಹಳ್ಳಿಗೆ ಸುಮಾರು ಹತ್ರ ಹತ್ರ ಇರೋಕೆ ತುಂಬಾ ಹೆಲ್ಪ್ ಆಯ್ತು. ಅದರಿಂದ
ಮತ್ತೆ ಬೇರೆ ಕೆಲಸಕ್ಕೆ ಇಟ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೀರಾ? ನೀವೇ ಮಾಡ್ತೀರಾ?
ನಮ್ಮ ಮನೇಲಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಅತ್ತೆ ಒಬ್ಬ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ, ಅವರು ಅಂಗವಿಕಲರು, ಕೈ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಇದಾಗಿದೆ. ಅವರು ನಮ್ಗೆ ಹೆಲ್ಪ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅವ್ರು ನಮ್ಮ ಮನೇಲೇ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ, ನಮ್ಮ ಮಕ್ಕಳು ನಮ್ಮ ಜೊತೆಲೇ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅವ್ರು ಹೆಲ್ಪ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ನಮಗೆ. ಇವಾಗ ಅದೇ ಮಿಲ್ಲೊಂದಿಗೆ ಒಂದು ಮಿಕ್ಸಿ ತಗೊಂಡು ಒಂದು ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಅದೇ ಅಕ್ಕಿ ಹಿಟ್ಟೆಲ್ಲ ರುಬ್ಬಿ ಮಾಡಿ ಒಂದು ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಇನ್ನೂ ಇಂಪ್ರೂವ್ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಅಂತ ನಾನು ಒಂದು ಮಿಕ್ಸಿ ತಗೊಂಡಿದ್ದೀವಿ.
Okay, as she was just saying that they are looking at expanding, just last night they got a mixer, solar mixer is also added. So you know, the most often the most famous dosas and idlis, so we need batter for it. So the idea is to actually, because they are already milling, they're already getting the flour there, why not go and take a next step and create and make those batters and sell it. So right now they've already added a new solution to the business.
ಫಸ್ಟ್ ನಾವು ಅಕ್ಕಿ ರುಬ್ಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಒಂದು ಕೆ ಜಿ ರುಬ್ಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಒಂದು ಗಂಟೆ ಟೈಮ್ ಆಯ್ತಾ ಇತ್ತು. ಇವಾಗ ಅದೇ ಮಿಕ್ಸಿಲೆಲ್ಲ ರುಬ್ಬಿಕೊಟ್ರೆ ಅದು ಕೆಲಸದವ್ರಿಗೆ ಸಹಾಯ ಆಯ್ತದೆ ಮಾಡಿ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತಿದ್ರು. ನಮಗೂ ಅದೇ ಅದರಿಂದ ಮಿಲ್ಲಿನೂ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಅದು ಇದ್ದರಿಂದ ಮಿಕ್ಸಿನೂ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಏನೋ ನಮಗೆ ಸಹಾಯ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ, ಮುಂದೆ ಮುಂದೆ ಹೆಂಗೆ ಇಂಪ್ರೂವ್ ಆಗ್ಬೋದು ಅಂತ ಅಂದ್ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಮಿಕ್ಸಿ ಎಲ್ಲ ತಗೊಂಡಿದ್ದೀವಿ. ಇನ್ನು ಮುಂದೆ ಹೆಂಗೆ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಂಡು ಹೋಗ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೀವಿ ಹಂಗೆ.
So yeah, I mean, this I think gives a great example of the entire agricultural value chain. I mean, you see the need, you connect with the local farmers and then get the solution, and then also end it with the right product, which is the same. It used to take 1.5-2 hours to just to make that batter manually. Now it's done in a matter of minutes. So
I think one of the most critical points that she mentioned, that which is very relevant to a lot of us, what she's multiple times she said that once I finish my loan, and that financial inclusiveness that she spoke about, saying that once I finish my loan, previously she was saying she was in debt, she didn't know. Now that she has taken a loan, she said, once I finish my loan, because of the rice mill, I'll actually take my next product, which is a very critical point of actually saying that how do we create livelihoods that pushes people above the social sustainability line rather than just looking at poverty line. Just getting intervention to help people above poverty line is not going to get people out of poverty, because any sort of distress, like a stop in state labor, like if the husband loses labor, they go back to poverty. The question is, once they own a rice mill, which is an asset, plus financing, they go much above the social security line, that even any other small disaster will not let them go back to poverty. So the beauty is getting them, getting all of us here are in a social security line, because one way or the other we own assets, whether it's an educational asset or whether it's an hard asset. I think once we look at livelihoods, it's not just livelihoods, but how does it also link to assets and finance? And that's very clearly that she's very wonderfully articulated, that none of us would have done it in the way that she articulated. I think.
ನಮ್ಗೆ ಏನೇ ಸಹಾಯ ಬೇಕಿದ್ರು ನಮ್ಮ ಸರ್ ನಮ್ ಸರ್ ಹೆಲ್ಪ್ ಮಾಡೋದ್ರಿಂದ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಇಷ್ಟೊಂದು ನಮ್ಗೆ ಹೆಲ್ಪ್ ಆಯ್ತು. ನಾವು ಅಷ್ಟೊಂದು ಅತಿ ಭಕ್ತನದಲ್ಲಿ ಇದ್ದಿದ್ರಿಂದ ನಾವು ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಕಂಪ್ನಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಜನ ಸರ್ ಇಂದ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಅಷ್ಟೊಂದು ಸಹಾಯ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಆಯ್ತು. ಇನ್ಮೇಲೆ ಹಂಗೆ ಉಡಿಸ್ಕೊಂಡು ಹೋಯ್ತಾ ಇದೀವಿ, ಮುಂದೆ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಹೋಯ್ತೀವಿ. ಅದೇ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಮಾಡೋದು ತುಂಬಾ ಇಷ್ಟ. ಅದೇ ನಮ್ ಸರ್ ಈಗೂ ಎಲ್ಪ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಏನೇ ತೊಂದ್ರೆ ಬಂದ್ರು ನಮ್ಗೆ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ಅವ್ರು ಬಂದು ಸ್ವಲ್ಪಗೆ ವಿಷಯ ಮುಗಿಸ್ತಾರೆ. ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಹೇಳಿದ ತಕ್ಷಣ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಬಂದು ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಳ್ತಾರೆ. ಒಂದ್ಸತಿ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಮೋಟ್ರ್ ಸುಟ್ಟಾಗಿತ್ತು, ಅದೇ ಸರ್ ಫೋನ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಹೇಳಿದಾಗ ಮನೆಗೆ ಒಂದ್ ದಿವಸ ಬೆಕ್ಕಿತ್ತೆ ಬಂದು ಅದ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಸರಿ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಟ್ರು.
She's just thankful to for all the solutions, and also whenever there was an issue with the service and maintenance, it was taken care. I think it's probably the great context for the panel that we're going to have now. So Tumba, thank you. Shivamma, Tumba, thanks for that, sir.
We would now like to call upon Mr. Gautam Kumar Pradhan to set the context. He is one of the founding members of Harsha Trust, having grassroots experience of 18 years in the field of agriculture and irrigation. He was the CEO and executive director of Harsha Trust. He is also a national level resource person for value chain development in agriculture for National Rural Livelihoods Mission. Harsha Trust is a development organization working to enhance livelihoods, especially among the tribals in Odisha. At present, Harsha Trust works with more than 90,000 households. Welcome, Gautam sir.
Good morning, one and all. And just taking forward what Manjunatha and the colleague said about the context of diversification of agriculture, agriculture evolution system in agriculture. I would like to flag out issues and concerns related to agricultural evolution sector as well as energy efficiency in those sectors. So coming to agricultural evolution sector, whenever I am talking about agricultural evolution sector, there I am referring to the products from the farms to the fork. Means it is from the whenever I am referring farms, means it is the process being taken to, from the production sector to the final consumption sector. So when I am referring to the farm sector, actually it is totally based on three types of stages. The stages are basically pre-planting, then post-production cycle. Whenever we are talking about the pre-planting stage, so what are the things? Definitely, it starts from land development to planting of the crops. And in these contexts, actually, what happens in the most of the cases,
There are energy requirement in every sector. I would say that in agricultural sector, in small or large amount, there is always energy requirement, which can be catered either for the electricity or for different means of energy for connecting those assets. But in most of the cases, what happens actually, the energy requirement varies. Whenever you are going from planting to post harvest section, the energy requirement varies in a great extent. In most of the cases, the energy requirement in the post harvest sectors are much more than pea planting and planting section. The pea planting section means land development sector where most of the cases we use mechanization of agriculture. While we are talking about mechanization of agriculture, we are talking about plowing. In most of the cases, it has been seen that people are not willing to go for traditional way of plowing the lands, where we need tractor and power tillers. But nowadays, the efficiency of tractor and power tillers as well as the cost effectiveness of tractor and power tillers is very high. For small and marginal farmers, it is very difficult to afford those things. Affordability is a concern in that point of view. Yesterday, we have also discussed about planting and post harvest section. From planting sector, it depends upon only irrigation is the major component where we have been debated a lot for the small and marginal farmers. But still, we are looking ahead the concept of more crop, broad crop. This is what we want to see in our context. Basically, the people should grow more without with less applications of water and energy efficiency of water delivery system. So in that context, when we are talking about sustainability point of view, we are talking three things again. The first thing is people, second is planet, and third is profitability. So when I am talking about agriculture, people with agriculture, basically in this context, actually what happens is people are the new generation people, the particular youth are not willing to go for plantation of the field. And what is happening, that the small and marginal farmers are in stake. And in most of the cases, it's the identity crisis. In Odisha, I would say, people are, farmers are agitating for price, prestige and pension. So the basic reason is the identity crisis. Farmers are not really, not willing to be recognized as farmers. And they do not also know, they do not also want that their children or their next generations to go for the farming. Because they believe that the farming is not at all beneficial or profitable in the long run. But being an agriculturist and hardware implementer, I would say agriculture is still profitable. If at all, we can devise it in a different way, not in the traditional way. So this is what I talk about the people. And coming to the next to the planet, as a very complex issues like sustainability point of view means surroundings, whatever we are doing with the surroundings. And very clear on the global warming context and greenhouse gases conditions. So in that context, what is happening actually, if at all we are using the traditional type of machinery and mechanization of agriculture, so it is also giving, most of the cases, it is also giving higher greenhouse gases. And developing countries are spending their developing countries are responsible for this type of greenhouse gases, whereas developing countries are telling that we are having so much small and marginal farmers, and there is no alternative for doing this. And they are also responsible. The small and marginal farmers are contributing a lot towards mitigating those aspects in farming system. Then, as far as profitability is concerned, it is totally market driven. Market driven means anyway, whatever products we have to sell in the market. Only the market is, the concept of the market is which is always harmless. It never knows about who is the farmer and what is the product they are going to sell or they are going to produce. It totally depends upon the time. It depends upon the quality of the produce, what they are going to sell. So in the context, actually, what I want to say, since there are enough opportunity and possibility in energy, sustainable energy point of view, in entire region of the agricultural center. Of course, it is very complex and time consuming process. So let us come together, join hands, the government, the policy makers, the private sector companies and development workers. So they should join hands together so that in order to minimize the cost of fertilizer and maximize the profit. So for next half, one hour at least, we will be discussing, deliberating and debating on that. Thank you so much.
Now, I'd like to call upon the other panelists as well. We have Dr. Lalitha, Regi, who along with her husband Dr. Regi John started Tribal Health Initiative, a public charitable trust, and launched its activities in September 1993. She has also been instrumental in setting up and running the Tribal Farm Initiative, Sittilingi Organic Farms Association, and the Tribal Craft Initiative. She now divides her time between being a doctor and in activities involving women's empowerment. Welcome, Dr. Lalitha. Now, we'd like to call Mr. Malatesh, Assistant Director of Agriculture at District Agriculture Training Center in Chitradurga District. Has done his Masters in Agriculture from the University of Agriculture Science, Dharwad. He started his career in the banking center and served as an assistant manager in Syndicate Bank as well. But now, he's initiated a lot of innovative mechanisms in agriculture development in the district. Welcome, Mr. Puttannavar. Now we'd like to have Ms. Garima Kumari, a development professional with a decade of vast experience in working with tribal communities, primarily in Jharkhand. She works with CINI TATA Trust as a regional coordinator for Chota Nagpur region in Jharkhand and holds the responsibility of mainly rural livelihoods. Please welcome her on stage. Finally, we'd like to call upon Mr. Ganesh, Neelam to moderate the panel. With an experience of around 15 years in the field of rural development, he works towards creating disruptive technology solution that caters to community development. Mr. Neelam joins Ratan Tata Trust in 2004 as a program associate, handling their flagship program, Central India Initiative, that focuses on enhancing livelihoods of tribal communities in Central India. Pleased to have you here, sir. So the panel will go until 11:30, sir. So please take it forward. Thank you.
Less time than what we had thought of. So we ought to be a bit fast in terms of what we want to raise across to the large group in terms of our thoughts and processes. And I would be thank ma'am to set a strong context for the other session in terms of looking at value chain, which is also our topic. And while looking at value chain, look at the different elements of value chain and see where actually we can do something really relevant to address that particular challenge in the value chain. So what I would do is basically start with you, ma'am, in terms of giving a brief of your work that you do with the tribal communities, and how are you looking at value chain in that work that you do, and energy as a strong fit in that particular process.
I would like to thank the SELCO team for this opportunity to come here and learn from all of you. We are from a place called Sittilingi in Tamil Nadu. It's a tribal area. It's a valley in eastern Ghats. And there we started work. Tribal initiative started work there 25 years back in 93. With a firm belief that if you trust any community and train them, they can rise up to any level possible and look after themselves. So that was the base philosophy behind our work. And specifically in health, because what we see in India today is that majority of people, the common man, especially in rural areas, and also the marginalized people in the cities, they lack basic healthcare services. What we have is the public sector and private sector. The public sector, what happens is in most places are not bothered about the basic primary, secondary healthcare needs of the marginalized communities. And private sector is too expensive for them. So, though we talk about health tourism and whole lot of tertiary level healthcare facilities, there are a lot of primary healthcare needs in the common man are not addressed. So, a whole lot of people all over the world started talking about the third sector called the people sector, where people take the responsibility of health in their own hands, get trained, and do that. So that is also one of the things that is the foundation for tribal relationship. So we started working there with a small two-room hut as a hospital which the people built for us, and which has grown into a 35-bedded secondary level hospital now. And what is unique about tribal hospital is that it is a local people-run hospital. 95% of our staff, you know, all our nurses or paramedical or pharmacists, lab technicians or drivers or administrative people, all are local tribal girls and boys who got trained with us. And and we also have a community health program in two valleys, where we have trained farmers, you know, women farmers who had no formal education to look after the basic healthcare needs in the villages. And they have made remarkable changes in the health situation in the villages in few years, which medical professionals over decades have been talking about and didn't do. These are common people. So that you need a formal education to make changes like this is a myth. It is not needed. Now, after 10 years of working like that, now having set up a hospital and a community health program to run on a routine basis, we wanted future directions, because basically the team believed that in order to improve the health of a community, you have to look into the determinants of health. It is not just health care facility alone, that is a very small part of it. You have to look at what determines health or ill health. So naturally, we have to look at agriculture, food security, nutrition security, livelihood, and also the social and political factors which determine ill health. So we needed directions. So naturally, when we need directions, there is only one thing. Now you go back to people. So what we did in 2004-2005 was practically close down the hospital for 3 days a week, and we walked from villages to villages, meeting every single household and then calling them for meetings in the evening. And what came out strongly in those meetings was about agriculture, because people said that we were a food secure, nutrition secure community, we were healthy. But without knowing, we were drawn into a different mode of agriculture, at least partly. And we know that we are not healthy now because of the food that we are eating, and we are also in debt. So we know there is a problem, but we don't know how to come out of it. So then together we all decided that now if agriculture is a problem, then we need to start talking about it, and there should be a platform to talk about it. So as a result of this, several farmers groups were formed, which now over the years, it started I think in 2005-2006. Now it has grown into a society of 500 organic farmers, All of them are small farmers who have 1 to 3 acre land. So that happened. And then the stress of the society, which is called Sittilingi Organic Farmers Association, the stress of the society is that your food should come from your land. So getting back to traditional crops and eating them. So because over the years we are very clear about it, the relationship of good food, healthy food with health. So that is the stress. Your 90% of your food should come from your own land. And for all the farmers associated with SOFA, at least 50% of their cropping plan should be food crops. You know, that is very clear. So basically we started that on a health point of view, that people should get back to healthy food. And then after SOFA grew, what happened is there are excess food crops. You know, after your need, there are excess. So we naturally started thinking about value addition and selling it to organic markets. Now, another problem at the same time we started seeing there was that there are a lot of migration because our people are all small farmers and the agricultural policies are very much against the small farmer. And then the rains had been failing, you know, because we are going through the 5th year now of almost drought-like situation. So it is very difficult for the small farmer with smaller landholding to survive. So they started migrating to Tirupur, to power looms, to Kerala for construction labor, things like that. So what happened is we started looking at the relationship of health and migration because we found out that they are earning there when they go out elsewhere. But there is a whole lot of new health problems and new social problems associated with migration. So the thing is that the main factor which made tribal communities all over the world healthy was their diet. One of the things is diet. So the moment diet changes, then the health also deteriorates. And in India, now we are genetically prone to diabetes. The only thing that prevented tribal communities from becoming diabetic was their diet. So the moment there is a study also that in migrant laborers, in some small period of time, I don't know, 5 to 10 years, a major share of migrant laborers become diabetic because we have a healthy proneness. So all those lifestyle diseases, what we call as the non-communicable diseases, you are seeing increasingly more in communities which didn't have. Not that it is high, but it is there. So that is just one part of a physical health. But another thing which we saw is the whole thing of what migration does. Because many times people ask us, you know, people ask, some of us who have professionals who have decided to live in villages, they say that oh, you are sacrificing this. It is the other way around. We are not sacrificing anything. Actually, we do that because we have made the choice, that is our dream, and we enjoy doing it. But for a laborer, for a migrant laborer from a village who comes to the city, he or she is forced to do it because there is no choice. And they actually sacrifice quite a lot when they come to cities. It is, it may be their food, their lifestyle, the way they look at life, their freedom, their individuality, their self-respect. Everything that you value as a human being has to be sacrificed to be in a city as a migrant laborer. So the thing is that given a choice, they would like to be in the village. So I think we have to look at livelihoods in that light. Because our people say that, no, if I get half what I earn in a city, in a village, around the year, I would happily be here. Because when you think about rural livelihood, this is what you think. It is not that you are giving, just like Gautam was earlier telling, it is not just an employment. It is respecting a fellow human being, with all the respect that he or she deserves. That is how you have to look at rural livelihood. So far what we are doing now is that value addition of whatever excess food crops that we have. So mainly in our place we grow millets. You know, we have five kinds of millets, then pulses and oil seeds, turmeric. Now in years when we have slightly moderate rain, we also grow organic cotton. So these crops are value added in a center. About 15 people work full time on this value addition. We have about 12 different machines, you know, doing value addition of all these crops. And these are all solar power. So thanks to SELCO for the thing. We have a 7.5 watt solar power for all these machines put together. So it is not that 15 people work, it is this income from 500 families, you know, produced from 500 families, which are being processed. We are also, our hospital also is solar powered, operation theater, our labor room, our newborn unit, all are solar powered. And also we have another society of 60 Lambadi women who have revived their traditional craft. So their center with the tailoring unit and everything also is all the tailoring sewing machines all also are solar powered. So now the if you look at energy, you know how it has enabled all these things to happen for 500 families. Otherwise would have been elsewhere. Otherwise would have been elsewhere as migrant laborers. It is only because of we have thought about augment energy. And because in our place there is electricity, but at least 18 hours in a day during summer and all, it is low voltage. So no way a machine can run. If at all it runs, it will get damaged. You know? So it is only because of the alternate energy that we are able to do that.
Thanks. We're talking about agriculture value chain, but they have a good background about the work that they do in the healthcare system, and also how energy becomes a very good fit in the healthcare.
Agriculture is health. It's not different.
That's right. The combination of agriculture and health. I will move to Garima. So Garima, you're doing this program called Lakhpati Kisan. So if you can briefly talk about the program and how are you looking at agriculture value chain and sustainable energy coming as a good fit to ensure that you achieve the goal of the
program. Thank you, Lakhpati Kisan is one of the flagship initiative program is done by the Tata Trust, and we are working in the CINI, and CINI is implementing in the 4 states. Jharkhand, Odisha, Chhattisgarh, and Gujarat. My experience is mostly around the Jharkhand, and so I will speak about the experience I have in Jharkhand. So, first, the main objective of this Lakhpati Kisan is to enhance the income of the farmer up to more than a lakh rupees, and we are doing it with the three prototype activities like agriculture, lakh, livestock. So I will first go through the lakh activities which we have done in Jharkhand. Through lakh we have made some Lakhpati Kisan also, and in the from the lakh we work in the pre-production part, production part, and the post-production part. In the pre-production part we identify the gap area and given a solution. With the help of the SELCO Foundation, we have given the solution of in lakh. The major gap area we identify in the pre-production side are the at the time of the major crisis is the labor at the time of the paddy transplantation, and the most of the labor goes in paddy transplantation rather than they are going to cutting the tree and pruning the tree and harvesting the crop of lakh. So this is the major problem, and climbing of tree 10 to 20 feet is also a big, big problem in this. With the help of SELCO Foundation, we have introduced a Pruner machine which is solar operated, and through that the scrapping of cutting of tree is done by that Pruner. So efficiency in this efficiency increase, it's about it takes a man to a person to do tree cutting in the day. It goes to 6 to 8 tree can be cut in a day. So efficiency increase 3 to 6 times in this pruner machines. Then we go on the, we identify the gap area in each segment. In the production side, we identify the gap area that measure the things done is the application of pesticide. And the application of pesticide, we earlier we are using a machine called gutter machine, and the gutter machine is operated by 2 to 3 person. So it's also require a labor. So labor challenges is a major issues in our area. So this is the power operated, the solar power operated sprayer is used, and this is used by the only one person. So here also we reduce the labor in this segment in the production part. And in the post-production part, we have done 2 to 3 segment in the just like the pruner is also used in the harvesting also. So the efficiency increase in the harvesting is just six times. And the processing machines we are using for crushing the lac. And that crusher machines is efficiency about 100 kg per day. But earlier what done by in our villages, mostly this was done by the our women only, and it is done by the local made knife of women. So the efficiency is 10 kg per day, but in the case of we are using right now we are using through electricity, but we are planning to do to power with solar with self foundation. So in this also we have seen that in the post-production part the efficiency is increasing. And right now the byproduct of the lac, just like the bangle making, and in this table also wax is used on the for the polishing purpose. So in the byproduct we are using the we have given training to artisan, and they are making bangles. And but the problem is there also that with the help of SELCO Foundation, we have introduced there a blower machine which is used in the furnace, and that blower machine we have seen in the blacksmith work. That blower machine is used in the furnace of the bangle making, and some luminary lights like exhaust fan light and this kind of thing are used to reduce the drudgery reduction for the pruner. So in the entire value chain of the lac, from the pre-production part, production part to the post-production part, we have seen that at least efficient energy and efficiency increase about 6 to 8 times in the whole value chain of the lac segment. And we move to the agriculture. Agriculture is the in the Lakhpati Kisan mission we have to increase the income of the farmer through agriculture also. And agriculture we have seen that our goal is to give return of 100,000 rupees from 1 decimal of land. And this is now our Lakhpati Kisan mission, we are at the 4th year of this stage. And at this point of time, we have seen that initially we are mostly focused on the production part of the agriculture. And in the production part of the agriculture, the income was coming 2 years before, we have seen that income was coming around 500 to 600 from 1 decimal of land. But by the using of precision farming, drip and mulching, we have seen that this increased up to more than 1,000. So, and this precision farming, we have seen that in our context, solar irrigation is a enabler in this precision farming and connecting with drip and mulching. Also, why I am saying the solar irrigation, because it is happened in a particular patch around in which around more than 20 farmers involved in that, and the production comes from the same patch of land. So that production is linked directly linked with the market. So in our context, farmer have very little amount of land. So in using this irrigation and using a large patch of land, about 15 to 20 acres of land, give marketable volume, and so the market is easily collected. So we have seen the efficiency of work in the solar energy also, in the solar irrigation. And by the time, in the 4 year of time, we have seen that the production is huge. So there is a problem and challenges we are facing, that storage of production we have identified with the SELCO foundation, that that can be done through the ecogen cold storage. So we are planning to do that also.
Thanks, Garima. That's a good brief in terms of what you are doing on agriculture value chain. So agriculture, as ma'am mentioned, health is agriculture. So in this case, agriculture does not mean only crops, but also look at other alternatives like that or something like that. I would now move to Dr. Malatesh. It's a very interesting story. He is actually a government official. And yesterday when I was talking briefly with him, he gave me a very good example on how he very differently tried to look at how the government system works and do something very different on innovating a particular work on energy and agriculture in his center. So it's not like order coming and then following that same order, but he tried to tweak the order with some mechanism and see that he is able to work closely with the farmers and address their needs. So if you can share your experiences on that piece, that would be very helpful.
Namaste. I basically come from a village named Kalsu from Samur Talu. I started the journey with the SELCO from my native, where we started a digital education to my government school, a primary and a high school, so, since 3 years before, last 3 years. So I started the journey with SELCO from 3 years back. I did not know. I knew only solar can have only light or fan or a, not education. I came to know when I was traveling to Bangalore last 3 or 4 years back. I met with Manjunatha, district manager of Chitradurga, and casually speaking, I came to know that he was from SELCO, and he was looking to some of the photos of digital education and light for education. So I thought, why can't we? I try in my school, a government school at Kalsu. And after 6 months, the dream came true, and we set up a digital education at the primary. And then also, with the help of my villages, high school and primary both were on digital education. And not only that, a computer center was running on, a school computer center is running on solar. And late for education, where we provided 50 lamps, solar lamps for 10 students or SLC students, so that they can learn in March to between the exam time. So there was very power cuts for them. So that came as a blessing to the students. And fortunately, a girl came to my house when I visited my native and told that, and I got a 92%. I was very happy. And she, in the future, she told that, I got 92% not only for my reading, I got the light for to read during the period of the power cuts. So I was very happy that an intervention can change on the life of the students. And coming to my, this one, I worked in a bank for 3.5 years as assistant manager, rural government, in a syndicate bank in Bijapur district. And then I switched on to as an agriculture officer in the Karnataka State Department of Agriculture. And I'm in charge of soil health center. Agriculture starts from soil. And I'm in charge of soil health center since 2004. A garage was given to me and to start a laboratory. A jeep shed and a little bit work was done in a laboratory. So I started the laboratory and thought of introducing solar in all these in the laboratory. And so slowly since 2 years, a small like pH meter, conductivity meter, which were running on electricity, now running on solar. So by 2 years, complete machineries, whatever, we go for 12 parameters, and the soil health mission, which runs the completely in India, what, you know, the basic for mission is for to reduce the consumption of electricity, a judicious use of fertilizer to reduce it for 20%, and thereby increasing the income of the farmer 20%. And that was the main mission for soil health mission. Through this mission, we got many funds to the all the laboratories in India, throughout India. So in that mission, we had got a component for mission management. So that mission management fund, we thought of using that mission management to solarize the laboratory, and it was done, and mostly it might be the first in India to be solarized. Complete lab is solarized, all the machines like pH, AS machines, atomic absorption, computers, all are now running on solar. This is how the funds are used from the government side to, in order to, because during the April or May, we are getting around 3 to 4 hours current shortages. Our lab will run on 2 shifts where 20 members are running in our lab. So once only a 1 hour cut, so it drags that work to the next batch. So they have to run, they have to work for another 2 hours in order to make up that work. So this is how the solar came as a blessing, and now there is no shortfall of time, and all the work, the analysis part and printing part, and completes within prescribed time. And coming to our district agriculture training, since 2 years I am in charge of district agriculture training center. We have got around 2.9 lakh farmers in our district, and basically our district is a drought prone area, drought prone and drought hit since 3 to 4 years. Around the lowest rainfall area is at our Chitradurga in Karnataka, that's called Chalkere. That's the taluk where we got a lowest rainfall in our district, and agriculture, when I think of agriculture, you think just for 3 to 4 hours drought, and you think agriculture. There is no green grass in just you can't find that in the field. Since that's the situation in my district. So coming to district agriculture training center, we train the agriculturists, not only agriculturists, also the extension officers or and other officers at our center. So we thought of training in such a way there that farmers can earn something. Our district is known for the millets. There are all 8 to 9 millets, around 6 to 7 millets are grown in Chitradurga. And it's one of our block or taluk, what is called as Hosturga, it is a bowl of millets. We thought of processing. So why can't we process it and then make some extra money to the farmer? This is how we started the discussion, and now we are planning for a solar link processing unit at Hosturga, 2 to 3 hamlets or groups. And not only that, we also made the complete center which where the center is running. We have got a museum. We turned that into a solar laboratory or demo plant, demo section, where all the aggressive processing units like flour mill or a chili pounding machine, or it may be a huller, paddy huller, or it may be a rotary rolling machine. These are all are running on solar. And not only that, our complete training center, which also we take the power to run also the training center also. This is how we have made it a dual purpose, a demo purpose, and also to run the training center also. And not only that, the rotary rolling machine is such a machine. The complete training, what the participants come or any candidate, the rotis or chapatis are prepared from that only. Since 2 years, we are preparing the chapatis and roti from those roti rolling machines. It's not a demo piece, it has become a part of our training center. And we are also pumping the water. Since we are, our two boreholes are now, there is no water for two boreholes. So now, since we are now energy sufficient or energy sustainable, but water is the scarcity for us, now we are thinking of a small tank or lake in our center, and also roof water harvesting at the center, so that we should be the water sustainable. So this is how we are bringing the solar and it's right to say that solar literacy in our district. Since along with that water literacy, we are thinking of water literacy, and the one of the vision is to convert the training center into the learning center. That's what my vision into the center is, to bring about that training into a learning center. And we are conducting most of the demos in our plant. And for example, Yesterday, Atik sir was speaking on tree mulberry. We have planted around 1 acre much tree mulberry. We have already planted it, 1 year old crop. So, since it comes in a low water capacity and tree mulberry such that we have planted in 10 by 10 so that a tractor can go for inter-cultivation and tree mulberry can also we can use it as a fodder for cattle, like local cattle, and then for also silkworms. So this is how we are trying for those technology which are really suited to our district or our locality, depending upon that range. So this is how we are taking our training, and not only training the officials. Last time we had also trained on mushroom cultivation to the beggars rehabilitation center. We had got around 265 beggars at our rehabilitation center. So the training can be given anyone if those by using these digital education and our ICT communication. So this is how we are going on the training center, mainly on the field base. And we, most of our trainings are conducted at the field level than at our center, because we came to know the needs or the problems when we go and visit their fields or the places of the farmers, rather than coming to the center and training. We ourselves go there and take the resource person depending upon their needs and train at their places.
Thanks, Dr. Malik. That's really an interesting story. And I think, like you said, the center should also learn and expand.
And we have got 22 hobbies, that's the right sampark kendras are there, where basic level offices of our agriculture department, where technology is transferred to the farmers and imports are provided. And these all 22 now are on solar. All the 22 offices are on solar, because that is the point where farmers come and interact. And now everything is online. In our department, now an application is given through online. Like he needs a machine, or he needs a spray machine, or he needs a sprinkler set, everything is online. Earlier, what were the 3 to 4 hours power cuts were there? When a farmer was coming, there was a lengthy queue. So that since current has to be, or we have to maintain the UPS. Now it's not a problem. Since UPS is provided on solar, it's a SELCO and department funds we have made it possible that 22, and not only this, it is multiplied in Raichur now. Out of 34 Rai Sampark Kendra at Raichur, 20 are now solar enabled. And the Koppal district, the joint director is very much impressed by those solar Rai Sampark Kendra. And now our officers said that Koppal, they were for training for 15 days at our center. And they were very impressed by this setting, and now the Koppal 25 Rai Sampark Kendra will shortly be on solar. So this is a multiplication has also been taking place.
Thanks a lot. Because we have time short, I will move to Gautam. Gautam, you gave a good context in terms of the three aspects of the value chain. What I would like to understand more from you is, what are the challenges that you still see in the field? When the say smallholder or a farmer has to adopt an energy efficient solution to improve their livelihood, so what are the challenges that you see?
Harsha Trust is basically working in Odisha, South Odisha particularly, and in southern districts. You might be knowing about the context of South Odisha. This is the most poorest of the poor block, poor region in the central India, and most of the tribals are living there in this context. And I would say in one season, every alternate year, either there is a flood or there is a drought. And you can also experience both flood and drought in one season as well. Because in most of the cases, we are getting the rainfall, we are about 1,500 to 1,600 in 1 year. But last year, if we compare this, in 1 day, we got 662 of rain in 1 day. So, to contextualize those things, actually, these are the vagaries of the climates where the farmers, most of the small and marginal farmers are living there. And basically, Harsha Trust is working for the livelihood enhancement of the poorest of the poor. And for the poorest of the poor, if at all I am talking about, we are targeting the tribal. And tribal having less than 1 acre or two acres of accessible land. We are talking about yesterday context, the accessible land is very less for them. And when we started intervening with those with an aim to increase the income, what happened actually,
in order to increase the income, you have to minimize the cost of cultivation or cost of production, otherwise market value can be increased. In the input side, in the backend side, actually, whenever we intended to go for production enhancement, we found that small and marginal farmers are willing to go for cultivation, that too diversified cultivation, but the only constant is the irrigation. On that context, actually, we tried to do something because, if at all, at the last stage of the crop, if they are looking at the time of crops, so farmers are demotivated for the next crop and they are migrating from the South Odisha. So we try to convince them, actually ensuring irrigation at the particular time was very important. And while at that time in South Odisha, the irrigation potential is only 17% to 13% to 17%. In this context, actually to motivate the farmer for diversification of agriculture and sustainable agriculture, it was very difficult for us. So we adopted solar technology because in the most of the cases electricity was the only option for irrigation, and that too I would say it's a life-saving irrigation. It was more important for them, for the tribal farmers, rather than a regular type of irrigation for round the year irrigation. So the total context was like this, and the farmers definitely we had to convince them for the ensuring irrigation for the solar. And we started our interventions in 2012 onwards, including solar-based irrigation system, where we tried to form the group of the people or this producer organization. Basically, we work with the farmers group, aggregating them or collectivizing them through producer organization, farmer producer organization, and through them. Yes, yes, sir. That is the challenges, very particular in the context of irrigation. The challenges is totally the cost of irrigation is quite high, and now we are trying to mitigate those aspects by collectivizing the farmers in a cluster approach. We have, to some extent I would say, we have been able to address those issues by clusterizing the agriculture or crop production system. And another thing is that after post production, because in most of the cases, what happens is the post production loss is quite high, 25% to 30%. And to restore those things, actually, in the post production section, the value addition starts. And electricity is not reliable and irregular at all, always. So to ensure those things, we have adopted so many equipments, solar operated equipments, in a clusterized approach, grouping them with the farmers and giving them with the farmers and being utilized for the farmers in the long run. So that is what we are going to see in the long run. Basically, in the clusterized approach, we are using all the equipments in solar powered system. This is solar fencing, solar winnowing, solar widows, everything is being built on solar. So that is what we want to actually progress on that aspect. So we want to replicate those models in future as well.
More like pH meter, conductivity meter, which were running on electricity, now running on solar. So by 2 years, complete machineries, whatever, we go for 12 parameters, and the soil health mission, which runs completely in India, whatever the basic for, mission is for, to reduce the consumption, that is a judicious use of fertilizer, to reduce it for 20%, thereby increasing the income of the farmer 20%. And that was the main mission for soil health mission. Through this mission, we got many funds to all the laboratories in India, throughout India. So in that mission, we had got a component for mission management. So that mission management fund, we thought of using that mission management to solarize the laboratory, and it was done. And mostly it might be the first in India to be solarized. Complete lab is solarized. All the machines like pH, AS machines, atomic absorption, computers, all are now running on the solar. This is how the funds are used from the government side. To in order to, because during the April or May, we are getting around 3 to 4 hours current shortage. Our lab will run on 2 shifts where 20 members are running in our lab. So once only a 1 hour cut, so it drags that work to the next batch. So they have to work for another 2 hours to in order to make up that work. So this is how the solar came as a blessing, and now there is no shortfall of time, and all the work, that's analysis part and printing part, and completes in a, within Prasikarta. And coming to our district agriculture training, since 2 years I'm in charge of district agriculture training center. We have got around 2.9 lakh farmers in our district, and basically our district is a drought prone area, drought prone and drought hit since 3 to 4 years. Around the lowest rainfall area is at our Chitradurga in Karnataka, that's called Chalkere. That's the taluk where we got the lowest rainfall in our district. And agriculture, when I think of agriculture, you think just of 3 to 4 hours drought and you think agriculture. There is no green grass or green blade grass in just, you can't find that in the field. Since that's the situation in my district. So coming to district agriculture training center, we train the agriculturists, not only the agriculturists, also the extension officers or AIJA officers at our center. So we thought of training in such a way where that farmers can earn something. Our district is known for the millets. There are all 8 to 9 millets, around 6 to 7 millets are grown in Chitradurga. And it's one of the our block or taluk, what is called as Hosturga. It is a bowl of millets. We thought of processing. So why can't we process it and then make some extra money to the farmer? This is how we started the discussion, and now we are planning for a solar link processing unit at Hosturga, 2 to 3 hamlets or groups. And not only that, we also made the complete center which where the center is running. We have got a museum. We turned that into a solar laboratory or a demo plant, the demo center, where all the aggressive processing units like a flour mill or a chili pounding machine, or it may huller, paddy huller, or it may be a roti rolling machine. These are all are running on solar. And not only that, our complete training center, which also we take that power to run also the training center also. This is how we have made it a dual purpose, a demo purpose, and also to run the training center also. And not only that, the roti rolling machine is such a machine. We have the complete training, what the participants come or any candidates, the rotis or chapatis are prepared from that only. Since 2 years, we are preparing the chapatis and roti from those roti rolling machines. It's not a demo piece, it has become a part of our training center. And we are also pumping the water. Since we are, our two boreholes are now, there is no water for two boreholes. So now, since we are now energy sufficient or energy sustainable, but water is the scarcity for us. Now we are thinking of a small tank or lake in our center, and also roof water harvesting at the center, so that we should be the water sustainable. So this is how we are bringing the solar and it's right to say that solar literacy in our district. Since along with that water literacy, we are thinking of water literacy, and the one of the vision is to convert the training center into the learning center. That's what my vision into the center is, to bring about that training into a learning center. And we are conducting most of the demos in our plant. And for example, yesterday Atik sir was speaking on tree mulberry. We have planted around 1 acre much tree mulberry. We have already planted, it's a 1 year old crop. So since it comes in a low water capacity, and tree mulberry such that we have planted in 10 by 10 so that a tractor can go for cultivation, and tree mulberry can also, we can use it as a fodder for cattle, like local cattle, and then for also silkworms. So this is what we are trying for, those technology which are really suited to our district or our locality, depending upon that range. So this is how we are taking our training center, and not only training the officials. Last time we had also trained on mushroom cultivation to the beggars rehabilitation center. We had got around 265 beggars at our one rehabilitation center. So that training can be given anyone, if those by using these digital education and our ICT communication. So this is how we are going on the training center, mainly on the field base. And most of our trainings are conducted at the field level than at our center, because we came to know the needs or the problems when we go to and visit their fields or the places of the farmers, rather than coming to the center and training. We ourselves go there and take the resource person depending upon their needs and train at their places.
Thanks, Dr. Malatesh. That's really an interesting story.
And I think like your sector, the private sector should also learn and expand.
We have got 22 Hublis, that's the right Sampark Kendras are there, where basic level offices of our agriculture department, where technology is transferred to the farmers and imports are provided. And these all 22 now are on solar. All the 22 offices are on solar, because that is the point where farmers come and interact. And now everything is online. In our department, now an application is given through online. Like he needs a machine, or he needs a spray machine, or he needs a sprinkler set, everything is online. Earlier, what would be 3 to 4 hours power cuts were there. When a farmer was coming, there was a lengthy queue. So that since current has to be, or we have to maintain the UPS. Now it's not a problem. Since UPS are provided on solar, it's a SELCO and department funds we have made it possible that 22, and not only this, it is multiplied in Raichur now. Out of 34 Rait Sampark Kendra at Raichur, 20 are now solar enabled. And now the Koppal district, the joint director is very much impressed by those solar Rait Sampark Kendra. And now our officers at Koppal, they were for training for 15 days at our center, and they were very impressed by this setting. And now the Koppal 25 Rait Sampark Kendra will shortly be on solar. So this is a multiplication has also been taking place.
Thanks a lot. Because we have time short, I will go to Gautam. Gautam, you gave a good context in terms of the three aspects of the value chain. What I would like to understand more from you is, what are the challenges that you still see in the field when the, say, smallholder or a farmer has to adopt an energy efficient solution to improve their livelihood? So what are the challenges that you see?
Yeah. Well, Harsha is basically working in Odisha, South Odisha particularly, in seven districts. You might be knowing about the context of South Odisha. This is the most poorest of the poor block, poor region in central India. And most of the tribals are living there in this context. And I would say in one season, every alternate year, either there is a flood or there is a drought. And you can also experience both flood and drought in one season. Because in most of the cases, we are getting the rainfall, we are about 1,500 to 1,600 in 1 year. But last year, if at all we compare this, in 1 day, we got 662 mm of rainfall in 1 day. So, to contextualize those things, actually, these are the vagaries of the climates where the farmers, most of the small and marginal farmers are living there. Basically, Harsha Trust is working for the livelihood enhancement of the poorest of the poor. And for the poorest of the poor, if at all I am talking about, we are targeting the tribal. And tribal having less than 1 acre or two acres of accessible land. We are talking about yesterday context, the accessible land is very less for them. And when we started intervening with those with an aim, with an aim to increase the income, but actually, in order to increase the income, you have to minimize the cost of cultivation or cost of production, otherwise market value can be increased. When in the input side, in the backend side, actually, whenever we intended to go for production enhancement, we found that small and marginal farmers are willing to go for cultivation, they do diversified cultivation, but the only constant is the irrigation. On that context, actually, we tried to do something because, if at all, at the last stage of the crop, if they are looking at the dying of crops, so farmers are demotivated for the next crop and they are migrating from the South Odisha. So we tried to convince them, actually, ensuring irrigation at the particular time, was very important. And while at that time in South Odisha, irrigation potential is only 17% to 13% to 17%. In this context, actually, to motivate the farmer for diversification of agriculture and sustainable agriculture, it was very difficult for us. So we adopted solar technology, because in most of the cases, electricity was the only option for irrigation. And that too, I would say, it's a life-saving irrigation. It was more important for them, for the tribal farmers, rather than a regular type of irrigation for round-the-year irrigation. So, in the The total context was like this, and the farmers definitely we had to convince them for the ensuing irrigation project so on. And we started our interventions in 2012 onwards, regarding solar waste irrigation system, where we tried to form the group of the people, or this is from the producer organization. Basically, we work with the farmers group, aggregating them or collectivizing them through producer organization, farmer producer organization, and through them. Yes, yes. So that is the challenge, is very particular in the context of irrigation. The challenges is totally the cost of irrigation is quite high, and now we are trying to mitigate those aspects by collectivizing the farmers in a cluster approach. We have, to some extent, I would say, we have been able to address those issues by clusterizing the agriculture crop production system. And another thing is that after post production, because in most of the cases, what happens is the post production loss is quite high, 25% to 30%. And to restore those things, actually, in the post production section, the value addition starts. And electricity is not reliable and irregular at all, always. So to ensure those things, we have adopted so many equipments, solar operated equipments, in a clusterized approach, grouping them with the farmers and giving them with the farmers and being utilized for the farmers in the long run. So that is what we are going to see in the long run. Basically, in the clusterized approach, we are using all the equipments in solar power system. This is solar fencing, solar winnowing, solar widows. Everything is being built on solar. So that is what we want to actually progress on that aspect. So we want to replicate both models in future as well.
We have about 5 minutes on this. So we take max 2 questions to the panel, and if you can just address the question to a particular panel, or it's open to everybody, you can mention that. So we have a hand over there. Two of them you already have.
To anybody who looks at this republic from Odisha. Actually, in one side, agriculture contributing less in GDP in India, and in other side, in rural income, the agro-based industry is contributing more. So where the value chain is missing?
No.
I had a question for Dr. Regi. So you elaborated upon the value chain in healthcare and agriculture. So I just wanted to ask you, where else do you think there's a need for energy intervention in those value chains, and what kind of support would you require from policymakers for the same? And if time permits it, maybe you could just briefly touch upon the replicability of your model in other tribal regions.
My question is to Gautam. I would like to know, because you talked of producer organizations and they're managing the solar systems collectively, what are the challenges of that, if they are managing?
So basically, in our experience, actually, more of the value chain processes are based on the post-production section. Because it totally depends upon whenever we are talking about post-production, means food diversity is moving forward, and most of the value chains are associated with taste and diversity. So the cost effectiveness, and of course our lifestyle, changes in lifestyles also are mostly responsible for this. We want that ready-made food should be available and processed food should be available at the plate. So for this, actually, these are the sectors, actually, food processing sectors are going to be more important in the future context, and most of the industries are focusing on that rather than in the production sector. And coming to the producers organizations are taking in a collective way to manage the solar based either irrigation and all the implements or the equipments associated with them. I would say ready processing center is one there. So all the producers organize, all the producers from the, not all the producers, but the representative of the producers, they are coming with there, and they are giving their labors, and
ensuring that these products are finished one and marketable one.
So,
this challenge is in both aspects. Basically, one challenge is that throughout running in the year round operation of those equipments and materials are the most challenges that we people are facing, because we have one solar cold storage. Now, even if when we thought that we need one cold storage for better marketability of the produce, but for the peak season, it is remaining full, and the rest of the time it is remaining idle. So the efficiency is yet to be ensured for this.
I think the model of SOFA and now they are producer company also. I think the value addition and the organic farming and implementation, that I think is definitely replicable, especially in homogeneous, especially in tribal community. Policy, yes, because there are a lot of challenges in farmer states, you know, like, our people do millet farming, but there are a lot of challenges in millet farming. Always, you know, in policy they talk about millet processing, but not at the level of, you know, how the farming, you know. There are a lot of challenges in that, you know. So those things could be from the farming level to the final level, you know, how we can help the farmer. That definitely is a need. And we have to think that in, shouldn't think that in isolation. Different sectors, you know, energy one, agriculture something else, health different, healing something, you know, craft. No, I think all this basically matters down to people. You know, so I think all these sectors have to start thinking together.
Thanks a lot. Thanks everybody for listening patiently. Great.